I can see him today. His eyes were blazing. His face got red. And he said, "Stand on your feet, black boy. You can't sit down here." So I decided, and I was only about 8 years old, that I was going to stand against that kind of thing the rest of my life.
In the late 1950s, job discrimination was one of the most significant barriers to economic prosperity. This fostered the poverty that fell upon black people across the country. Black people were only able to find work in fields that required menial labor, and they were rarely ever hired into jobs that required any expertise. In attempts to combat job discrimination, a Philadelphia minister named Leon Sullivan dedicated his life to creating opportunities for black people to find promising work positions and obtain economic stability. Leon Sullivan dented the barrier of discrimination in employment in Philadelphia through the Selective Patronage Campaign, which gave black people the opportunity to be hired into quality job positions. This led to the Opportunities Industrialization Center, which provided people the training required to maintain these jobs, and Progress Plaza, which hosted black-owned and operated businesses. In the long term, this resulted in the continued training services of the OIC and the establishment of new businesses in Progress Plaza. The 1950s are considered a time of prosperity in the United States. After a victory in World War II, the economy was booming and most people felt like they were living the true American dream. But with the success of some came the struggle for others. The late 1950s also marked the beginning of a social and political movement for African Americans to receive the same rights as their white counterparts. In 1955, Martin Luther King Jr. assisted the Montgomery Improvement Association in organizing African Americans to boycott against segregated Montgomery buses. Then, in the beginning of 1960, college students launched a series of protests known as the Southern Sit-ins, because black people were not allowed service at whites-only lunch counters in North Carolina. These events inspired many people to take part in the civil rights movement and proved that demands for racial equality can be met when there is a unified group of people working together for a common goal. Inspired by these events, Leon Sullivan began his own movement to tackle discrimination in Philadelphia. At the end of the 1950s, the number of black people in Philadelphia surpassed 300,000, as a result of the influx of African Americans who migrated north during World War I and World War II, due to the attraction of northern jobs and industrial enterprises. When black people migrated to Philadelphia, they could settle into limited neighborhoods due to redlining policies and racial violence. One neighborhood that had a particularly high concentration of black people was North Philadelphia. However, as more black people were forced to move into North Philadelphia, more white people fled. Soon enough, North Philadelphia was a predominantly black neighborhood that suffered from urban decay, ghettoization, and neglect by city officials. Furthermore, during the late 1950s, black Philadelphians made up 43% of the unemployed population in Philadelphia. Not only were black people less likely to find employment, but they were also less likely to find employment in quality, well-paying jobs. This neighborhood segregation and inequality in the workplace paved the way for the development of a primarily black lower class in Philadelphia.
The city in the 1950s is rapidly turning to be one of the most segregated cities in the country. That segregation isn't accidental. That was built into a lot of policy decisions and a lot of legal restrictions and a lot of resistance.
The desire to help black people break the barriers that caused this forced poverty would become the driving factors for Leon Sullivan's projects in the future. Leon Sullivan was born in West Virginia in 1922, where he was first exposed to racial discrimination. When he was just 18 years old, he became a Baptist minister and moved to New York to serve under Reverend Adam Clayton Power Jr. Then in 1950, he came to Philadelphia to become the minister of Zion Baptist Church. It was there where he first discovered the poverty-stricken neighborhoods that encompass North Philadelphia. He realized that the only way to help people get out of poverty was to help people find jobs. In attempts to break the barrier of job discrimination, Leon Sullivan realized that he needed to target companies economically and use the economic power of the black community to pressure prejudiced companies into hiring black workers into more visible and highly paid job positions. To carry out this plan, Leon Sullivan enlisted the help of 400 additional Philadelphia-based ministers who urged black people to stop buying from places where they could not work, in a boycott that became known as the Selective Patronage Campaign. The 400, or general gathering, would arrange a meeting with the top executive from a company. From there, a deadline would be given for the company to hire a certain number of black job seekers in the desired positions. If the requests were not met in the allotted time, ministers would go to their pulpits the next Sunday morning and announce a selective patronage against the company. The first company targeted was the Tasty Baking Company. The ministers proposed that the company hire black people to fill the roles of salesman drivers, office workers, and production line workers. Tasty Baking refused to meet these demands, and in response, black Philadelphians immediately stopped purchasing Tasty Cakes.
They were not hiring black drivers. They were not hiring our men and women to work in places other than civil service. Well, if we can't work there, we shouldn't be shopping there. I remember Leon telling us, don't eat Tasty Cake until you hear it from the pulpit.
After 3 months, Tasty Baking could no longer stand to lose the business that black people gave them, and they eventually hired two black women to the clerical staff and hired several black driver salesmen. After the success of the Tasty Baking campaign, Leon Sullivan and the 400 ministers launched an additional 28 campaigns against other prejudiced companies in the area. Once black people obtained quality jobs, the next step was providing them with job training so that they could keep these jobs. Numerous companies refused to hire black workers because they claimed that they did not have the skills needed to perform their jobs properly. This ushered Leon Sullivan to launch his most triumphant program, the Opportunities Industrialization Center, or OIC. Mr. Sullivan explained that OIC is a program of self-help and self-motivation to provide practical training which prepares persons for a variety of occupations. The program first began in 1964 in an abandoned jailhouse in North Philadelphia. Soon enough, the OIC began educating students in a variety of fields. On the opening day of the OIC, on January 26, 1964, more than 8,000 people showed up in hopes of receiving training. The OIC began to grow quickly, with several new training centers opening across the city and in the areas that surrounded Philadelphia. After 6 months of training, 80% of the students at OIC were able to get well-paying jobs and continue to advance in high positions within their fields. The added job training that became available assisted black people in obtaining better jobs and continued the fight against the barrier of job discrimination. Sullivan's next proposal to help break the barrier of job discrimination was through Progress Plaza. The goal of Progress Plaza was to help African American business owners succeed by giving them a prominent location to place their businesses and create new jobs. Progress Plaza became the first shopping center in the United States to be developed, owned, and managed entirely by African Americans. To fund the plaza, Leon Sullivan initiated the 1036 plan in 1962.
With this 1036 plan, with people contributing $10 a month for 36 months, we were able to secure enough funds to launch out on this massive endeavor.
By 1967, the 1036 plan raised over $2 million for Progress Plaza, which would house 16 black managed businesses on Broad Street, one of the most prominent streets in Philadelphia. The Progress Plaza and the OIC are both short-term and long-term effects of the Selective Patronage campaign that still impact the community today. Progress Plaza went on to create its own black-owned businesses under the Progress name, such as Zion Investment Associations, as well as continue to be an outlet for black businesses in Philadelphia. Today, the OIC is an international program that continues to provide people with essential job training all over the world.
So last year, 1,500 citizens improved their lives and got specific job training from OIC. Over 3 million people have been serviced by OIC, which allowed them to get good jobs and take better care of their families.
Leon Sullivan's projects deeply impacted the issue of employment in Philadelphia, but his contributions to the civil rights movement are often untold and overlooked. What many people fail to recognize is the vast opportunities he gave African American people in the workplace and the sense of self-empowerment that he created for the black community. Although discrimination in the workplace is a barrier that is not entirely broken, Leon Sullivan was able to dent this barrier and open up the opportunity for black Americans to find quality jobs, receive job training, and become economically successful as a community.